It is my great pleasure today to welcome Professor Maria Kafesaki from the Foundation for Research and Technology in Hellas, so in Crete, in Greece. And Professor Kafesaki is going to speak today about parity time, so PT symmetry in chiral electromagnetic metamaterials. Professor Kafesaki.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for the invitation. It is an honor for me and it's a pleasure to meet the acoustic metamaterials community since my PhD, quite a long time ago, was in acoustics. So today I am going to speak about electromagnetic metamaterials, actually, and I will speak about parity-time symmetry in chiral electromagnetic metamaterials. This is a work that has been done in Forth and the University of Crete, and the people that they have done the really the heavy work. Let's see if here he is, Yannis Katsantonis and Sotiris Droulias, which appear here, and I will start with some introduction on parity time symmetry first, and then a few words about chirality and chiral metamaterials for the people who are not familiar with. And then I will start describing our own work, which is attempts to combine chirality and parity time symmetry in a single system. I will speak about the conditions for a parity time for a chiral metamaterial to be PT symmetric. And then I will discuss more scattering properties of parity-time symmetric systems based on the simplest possible system that is shown here, a chiral bilayer involving gain and loss. I will describe the scattering characteristics under normal incidence and under oblique incidence. There are some important differences. And I will finish with some proposals for practical implementation on chiral parity time symmetric systems. So what you may have seen that the concept of parity time symmetry is a concept which has been discussed a lot in recent years, and it started from Schrödinger equation, which I list here. And from the paper by Bender in 1998, and in quantum mechanics, actually, we use Hermitian Hamiltonians to ensure that the energies are real quantities. But what Bender showed is that it's not essential Hamiltonian to be Hermitian to have real eigenvalues, but parity time symmetric Hamiltonians is a class of Hamiltonians which can have real eigenvalues if they are not Hermitian. In other words, the hermeticity of the Hamiltonian is a sufficient but not necessary condition for the realness of the eigenvalues. And and by parity time symmetric Hamiltonian, actually, I mean a Hamiltonian that commutes with a parity and the product of parity and time operators, as it's shown here. And just to be sure that we are all on the same page, here is a summary of what parity and time operators they do on the physical quantities. The parity corresponds to spatial inversion. It reverses the moment, the position and momentum vectors, and all the polar vectors like the electric field, while it leaves unchanged the axial vectors like the magnetic field. On the other hand, the time reversal operator reverses the time. It performs conjugation. It leaves the space unchanged, and it reverses it. It leaves the all the polar vectors unchanged, and it changes. It reverses the axial vectors. For a Hamiltonian to be parity time symmetric, the condition that the resulted condition is the one shown here, which says that the real part of the potential should be even function of space, and the imaginary part should be odd function of space, like an example shown here. And Here I show some picture which is quite general in parity-time symmetric system, is the imaginary part of the eigenvalues, the energies in this case, as a function of the strength of the potential, or whatever determines the strength of the potential. And you can see that below some critical strength of the potential, the imaginary part of the eigenvalues is zero, and this phase is called full parity-time phase or parity-time symmetric phase, while beyond this critical point, the eigenvalues get an imaginary part. They are not real. They are not real anymore. And this is the parity-time broken phase. And we call it like that because in the first phase, not only the Hamiltonian is parity-time symmetric, but also the eigenfunctions are parity-time symmetric. While in the latter case, in the next case, we have non-parity-time symmetric eigenfunction. Now the region that separates the two, the point actually separating these two regions is called exceptional point. It's a very interesting point because it's a time is a point where both eigenvalues and eigenvectors coincide. So the space is collapsed in some sense. And most of the interesting effects in this kind of systems, they are observed around close to exceptional point or just after the exceptional point. And actually, because the system is very, very sensitive, the propagation is very sensitive around this exceptional point, this point offers unique possibilities for sensing. And it has been proposed, there is a variety of works which have been demonstrated sensing based on the exceptional point, around the exceptional point. Now, although the parity-time symmetry concept started from the Schrödinger equation, was very quickly transferred in optics, where the first works were based on the mapping between Schrödinger equation and wave equation in the paraxial approximation. Here, I saw the wave equation in the paraxial approximation where you don't have material variation along propagation directions. And if you see this equation, it's exactly the same, it's exactly equivalent with the Schrödinger equation, with the potential being proportional to frequency and to the refractive index. So applying the parity-time symmetry in this type of Hamiltonian, following exactly the Schrödinger procedure, we see that the condition is translated to a condition on the refractive index, which dictates that the refractive index to have even real part and odd imaginary part. And it is well known that a position, a refractive index with a negative imaginary part corresponds to a gain material. So in the case of optics, there is the possibility to realize parity-time symmetry quite easily by properly combining loss and gain media. And this way, the opportunity to observe and to demonstrate the nice features that they are associated with parity-time symmetry was given. So the optical systems, actually, they are now, I think, much more explored than their Schrödinger counterparts. And here is one of the first system where parity-time symmetry was demonstrated, and is a loss waveguide next to a gain waveguide, and it was shown that in the parity-time symmetric phase, the mode in this the propagation mode is symmetric between the two waveguides. The propagation actually is symmetric between the loss and gain, while if you go beyond the exceptional point, then the mode becomes asymmetric, and you have, depending on the situation, a higher concentration of the wave in the gain side or in the loss side. Now, if we go beyond the paraxial approximation, then this requirement about the refractive index should be replaced by the more general relations regarding, which are the same relations, but this time for the permittivity and the permeability. These relations, they can describe very well scattering, parity-time symmetric scattering systems. I said that the application in optics gave the chance to observe and demonstrate all these nice features associated with parity-time symmetric systems. And here I list some of those effects and peculiar, let's say, properties. One peculiar effect is the unidirectional invisibility, and more generally, the unidirectional reflectionless propagation. Here is we have a waveguide, and if we send a wave from the left side, then we don't have reflection, and we have the possibility to have the transmission here not only united in magnitude, but with a proper phase, as this is to make this system invisible. While if you send the wave from the other side, then you have reflection, which destroys this invisibility. It has been demonstrated. Another interesting effect, to my opinion, is what is called loss-induced transparency, observed in this type of system. When you, as you increase the loss, you increase the transmission, and it's based on the fact that the increased loss pushes the mode to more towards the gain side. So as a result, we have higher transmission. Also, we have in this type of systems negative refraction and the flat superlensing, like in the usual negative refractive index metamaterials. But the most fascinating, let's say, and the well-studied effect is what is called CPA laser of parity-time-symmetric systems. In this type of systems, one can have a coherent, perfect absorption and lasing at the same frequency, and you can excite either the CPA mode or the lasing mode by adjusting the input wave, the relation between the left and right input waves. And this CPA lasing has been demonstrated in a variety of systems. Here is one example, which is system based on 3-5 semiconductors. So our interest now is to see how we can extend these effects in chiral systems. If we can achieve similar effects in chiral systems, and what more you can achieve by combining parity-time symmetry with chirality. And few words about chirality for people that are not familiar. By chiral structure, we mean a structure which is not identical to its mirror image. It's mirror asymmetric. And the characteristic effect is that the applied electric field, more accurately, induces not only an electric dipole moment, but also a magnetic dipole moment collinear to the electric dipole moment. So this magneto-electric coupling is described by this equation here, by this constitutive relation shown here, which besides permittivity and permeability, they have also this parameter kappa, which is a parameter quantifying the electromagnetic coupling. Now, the involvement of these constitutive relations to the Maxwell's equations, the merging of this relation with the Maxwell's equations, results to the fact that the eigenmodes in this type of systems, they are the circularly polarized waves. Here with a plus subscript, I denote the right-handed circularly polarized wave, and with a minus, the left-handed circularly polarized wave, either with plus or RCP or minus or LCP. And also in this systems, we have a refractive index which is different for left and right hand circularly polarized waves, and the index besides permittivity and permeability depends also on the chirality parameter with a different sign for left and right waves. Now the consequence of this different diffractive index, both real and imaginary part, actually, this different diffractive index has two important consequences for the wave polarization. One is the rotation of a linear polarization if the wave goes passes through a chiral medium, and the other is the circular dichroism, which means that we have different absorption for left and right-handed circular polarization. So this has as a result, if we have a linearly polarized wave and we send it to pass through a chiral medium, taking into account that this linearly polarized can be decomposed into plus and minus circular polarization, and one of the two is and they absorb differently, the output polarization will be elliptical polarization and rotated, of course, and this ellipticity, the degree of ellipticity, let's say, is quantified with the ellipticity parameter here and the optical rotation by the parameter theta here. Both parameters, they can be calculating the transmission coefficient for left and right-handed circular polarized waves. Actually, eta, when eta is zero, we have linear wave. When eta is 45 degrees, we have circular wave. So these two properties, they give to chiral structures unique possibilities for polarization manipulation. So it's an effect we usually want to control in studying chiral metamaterials. Now, as I said before, our interest was to see if we can achieve parity time symmetry in chiral metamaterials which are inherently parity asymmetric, and if yes, under what conditions? And to study this question, we started from the Maxwell's equation, and we plugged in the constitutive relations. And if we solve the equations in terms of the fields B and D, we get an eigenvalue, a regular eigenvalue problem, which, like I show here. When we solve in terms of E and H, it's actually we get a generalized eigenvalue problem, which is not that easy to handle like this one. So, merging these equations, we obtain a system like that, which is a simple eigenvalue equation. And here are the how the Hamiltonian, the equivalent Hamiltonian, looks like. I think it's not important to stay in this formula, in the formulas here. So we try to examine the possibility for parity time symmetric chiral systems by examining if this and under what conditions this Hamiltonian commutes with the parity and time operators. And the answer is that indeed the Hamiltonian can be commute with the parity and time operators, and the conditions, the required conditions, are listed here. For the permittivity and permeability, the conditions, they are the same that we encounter in non-chiral systems. And for the chirality parameter, we have the opposite condition. So the chirality should have odd real part and even imaginary part for a system to be parity time symmetric. Now, we wanted to examine the wave propagation in this type of systems, in a system fulfilling those conditions, and more specifically, we would like to examine the scattering properties of such systems. And for that, we picked up the simplest possible system, which is a system of homogeneous and non-dispersive chiral media, like a gain loss bilayer, as it's shown here, with uniform permittivity, permeability, and chirality parameters in the layers. So we wanted to investigate the scattering properties of those systems if we send left or right-handed circularly polarized waves. I make a parenthesis here, and because to say a few words about scattering systems, it has been shown even that in non-chiral systems that the parity time symmetry phases in scattering systems can be identified from the eigenvalues of the scattering matrix in this time, which is the relevant quantity for in the scattering systems. And by scattering matrix, we mean the matrix here connecting the input wave, the blue arrows shown here. This is a scattering matrix for non-chiral systems, for the simplest possible, let's say. And it has as elements, the reflection from left and the reflection from right, and the transmission from, there is a mistake here. So the scattering matrix connects the input waves, the blue ones, with the output waves, the scattered waves. And when one calculates the scattering matrix for a parity time symmetric system, he/she can observe that in the so-called parity-time-symmetric phase, the scattering matrix eigenvalues are unimodular. They have modulus equal to 1. While beyond, while in the parity-time broken phase, only the product of the scattering matrix eigenvalues are unimodular and not its eigenvalue separately. So the region, the exceptional point is the region separating in these two phases here, the PT and the PT broken phase. And so calculating the scattering matrix eigenvalues, one can identify and locate the parity time symmetry phase and the parity time broken phase and the exceptional point where, as I said before, all the most interesting physics appears. This is the approach that we use actually to study our scattering system, our PT, parity-time symmetric chiral bilayer. And but in our case, because we have the possibility to have left and right-handed to send to the system left and right-handed waves, we have four input and four output channels. So our scattering matrix is four times four. And the question, like in also in the smaller system of 2x2, is how to array. You get different scattering values, different scattering matrices if you arrange differently the input and output ports. So a question was how we should arrange the input and output port in our system in order to be able to achieve the picture that you saw in the previous slide regarding the parity time eigenvalues in the eigenvalues of a parity time symmetric system. And we found actually that this is the correct arrangement is as I saw here. We can discuss further about that later, but this is the matrix that fulfills the what is called generalized unitarity relation for the S matrix that is obeyed by parity time symmetric systems. And here I have already simplified this matrix for the case of normal incidence. And I have taken into account some general characteristics of the chiral systems. For example, one characteristic is that only if you send a wave, plus or minus wave, only the cross-polarized reflection is different than unity, while the co-polarized reflection, the reflection coefficients are always unity. Moreover, the transmission coefficients, we don't see here transmission from the left and transmission from the right because our system is reciprocal. So these two transmissions, they coincide. And the only different transmissions, they are for the one you obtain when you send plus right-handed circularly polarized waves, you get a right-handed wave output in the transmission. And the tough minus minus, you send minus and you achieve minus wave. You see that all these components of the scattering matrix are the transmission and reflection coefficients. So we calculate the transmission and reflection coefficients for a general chiral bilayer before applying any time symmetry, any parity time symmetry requirement. And we observed some interesting characteristics. One of them is that the reflection coefficients are totally independent of the chirality parameter. They depend only on the permittivity and permeability. So they are equal to their non-chiral counterparts. On the other hand, if you calculate the transmission coefficients, here I saw a calculation of the transmission and reflection for normal incidence is shown here. Here is a non-chiral system, and here is a chiral system with a chirality in the plus and in the gain and in the gain and loss medium, as I shown here. And you can see the blue, for example, the reflection coefficient. You can see that the reflections are the same in non-chiral and in chiral systems, while the transmissions they are not the same. But what is the same is the resonance in the resonance and zeros of the transmission coefficients. They are the same between the chiral and non-chiral metamaterials, and the only thing actually that changes is the magnitude of the transmission. You see that the chirality in these systems here that the transmission, that both the transmission for plus and minus waves are this black dotted line. Here you see that this transmission splits into two. So what chirality parameter actually does, it leads to growth of one circular polarization and to decay of the other circular polarization. So as I said before, the resonance position is totally independent on the chirality. And another parameter that does not depend on the chirality and it's critical for our system is the product of tough plus plus and tough minus minus. This product is equal to the square of the transmission coefficient in systems, in non-chiral systems, in the corresponding non-chiral systems. It means in the system that have the same permittivity, permeability, and zero chirality. On the other hand, now if we calculate the scatter, in this slide, we calculate the eigenvalues of the scattering matrix, and you see that the eigenvalues, they depend on the reflection coefficient, which is chirality independent, and on the product, tough plus plus, tough minus minus, which is also chirality independent. So the scattering matrix eigenvalues are totally independent on the chirality, which was very surprised for us in the beginning. And we can show this. Why it does not move? Okay. Also with simulations, here are the logarithms of the eigenvalues of a non-chiral parity time symmetric system. Only permittivity and permeability are the obey PT-symmetry requirements. And here is a system, a chiral parity time symmetric system. And you see that the eigenvalues of the scattering matrix, they are the same between these two systems. And there are some other conservation relations that they are obeyed in this type of parity-time symmetric systems. And in all these relations, I have listed here two of those relations. One is like it looks like energy conservation, but it's not actual energy conservation. You will see that everywhere there is the product of tough plus plus, tough minus minus, whenever we have the transmission. So all these relations that they are associated with parity time symmetry, they are totally independent of chirality. It means that the exceptional point, the position of the exceptional point, the parity time symmetry phases, and the CPA laser points, which are actually these, they will evolve in the spikes of the scattering matrix eigenvalues, they are totally independent on the chirality parameter. They depend only on permittivity and permeability. On the other hand, if we calculate the optical activity and the ellipticity, which are the dominant chirality dependent parameters, we see that even before applying parity time symmetry requirement, this optical activity and the ellipticity, they depend exclusively on the chirality parameter, and they do not depend on permittivity and permeability. And parity time chiral system, actually the optical activity is zero, but what changes a lot compared to the non-chiral system is the ellipticity, which can go easily from 0 to 45 degrees. So we can get from linear wave to circularly polarized wave. So optical activity and ellipticity depend exclusively on chirality, and this actually brings us to the important conclusion that we have the possibility to control independently the parity time related properties by changing permittivity and permeability, and to control independently transmitted wave polarization if we change the chirality. And we have the possibility to combine them at will, for example, achieving a CPA laser for circularly polarized waves. So if we have a possibility to tune independently chirality parameter and permittivity and permeability, then we have the possibility to superimpose at will the exceptional point, the reflection transmission resonance, and CPA laser points with the desired wave polarization, which is a quite important feature for applications. And I have to say that, okay, although in principle we cannot tune independently permittivity, permeability, and chirality, there are chiral metamaterial designs that they give us some flexibility. So we have some flexibilities for independent control. Now, if we go to off-normal incidence, the situation changes. Now we break the system, the propagation does not follow the system symmetry, and we see that the eigenvalues which in normal for normal incidence they form two degenerate pairs, here they don't form two degenerate pairs anymore. And this point is a point that I forgot to stress, that for normal incidence the eigenvalues they form two degenerate pairs. Here this degeneracy breaks, and the scattering matrix eigenvalues, if you compare for a non-chiral system and for a chiral system, you see that in both cases of normal incidence has as a result the appearance of a mixed phase, where the one pair of eigenvalues is in the parity-time symmetric phase and the other one is in the parity-time broken phase. This is the light gray here. This is the full PT phase. Both pairs, they are in PT phase. This is the mixed PT. One pair is in broken and one is in the full PT. And this is the broken PT. Both pairs, they are in the broken PT phase. Now, adding chirality in the system, we see that we have for this chirality parameter, we have some slight changes in the picture. And exploring more those systems, we found that the eigenvalues here, they do depend on the chirality parameters, and they can be controlled by changing the chirality parameter. Here is another example of such a system where the eigenvalues of the scattering matrix for zero chirality are shown with the dashed lines, and for non-zero chirality are shown with the solid lines. And you can see again the full PT phase, the mixed PT phase, and the broken PT. And you can see that the is not very, very well visible here, that the chirality has shifted, has changed the exceptional points, and has changed a little the eigenvalues. And we can observe this more in detail, let's say, in these graphs here, where we obtain the frequency just before 13 in these dimensionless quantities, and we of the system, and we change the chirality parameter. And by changing the chirality parameter, we see that the system goes from the full PT phase to mixed PT phase, and then it again re-enters in the full PT phase, mixed PT phase, and finally in the broken PT phase. So we have great possibilities to tune the parity time phase and to tune the exceptional points by changing the chirality in this game. The same can be observed for the other frequency, which is in the mixed PT phase for 30 degrees. This is the incident, 30 degrees, the incidence here. And changing the chirality again goes from mixed PT to full PT and to mixed to, and then to broken PT phase. Now so we have phase reentries, and we have possibilities to change to move the exceptional points, to tune the exceptional points via the chirality parameter. Another even more important thing, even more important observation, is that we have the same tuning possibility changing the angle of incidence. If we again we take this case here, the blue point, and we change the angle of incidence going from 30 to smaller and larger angles, and we see that the system again enters in the mixed PT phase in this case, and in the second case where the system is already in mixed PT phase for 30 degrees, we saw that it can increase in the angle of incidence. It can go to a full PT phase again, and the same is for all these three frequencies. So this shows that we have a great control of parity time symmetric features at the exceptional points, basically, through changing the chirality and, more importantly, changing the incidence angle, which is offers the possibility of dynamic control. Another, now going to the chirality effects, let's say, the optical activity and the ellipticity, here we saw for the system, the same of the previous slide, the optical activity, the theta parameter, and the ellipticity, the eta parameter, as we change the angle of incidence, and you see that if we change the angle of incidence, we can change both the ellipticity, which is for off normal incidence is not zero anymore. We can change both the optical activity and the transmitted wave ellipticity. This shows that we have angle dependent both optical activity and ellipticity. And even more, let's say, intriguing, more interesting effect is what you observe when you go from the other side. If you, this is for incidence from the left side of the slab, while when we go to the right side of the slab, we see quite different pictures. So the optical activity and the ellipticity is not only angle dependent, but they are also asymmetric. Both are asymmetric, they depend on the side. So this gives a lot of possibilities for polarization manipulation, for dynamic polarization manipulation. It demonstrates broad possibilities in this type of systems. These were the basic, let's say, features that I wanted to show, and I will finish with a few words regarding the practical realization of this type of metamaterials. A type of metamaterials that we think they are quite appropriate to realize this type of systems is the bilayer metallic structures like the ones shown here, which are composed of two metallic features mutually rotated or related in a way as to achieve a chiral response in these systems, like twisted crosses here, or twisted squares, or extended Z-shaped structures, and so on. In this type of systems, we have a strong field between the two conductors, between the two conducting elements. So if we place the gain material between the two conducting elements, then we have the possibility to enhance the effective gain, the effective loss and the effective gain, and to go beyond the gain limitations of the regular materials. And also they are structures that they can be fabricated by planar technologies. And they also, by, for example, in this type of cross structures, we can, changing the angle, for small angle changes, rotation angle between the two metallic components, you change the chirality parameter while you don't affect a lot the permittivity and permeability. So you have kind of, not exact, but kind of independent control of chirality and permittivity and permeability. And here is a simulation showing the effective permittivity, permeability, and chirality that we can get in this type of structure. Is a paper, an older paper by Soukoulis. And you can see that the parameters epsilon and mu and kappa that we have used, they are all achievable with this type of bilayer metallic structures. And here is a structure that we use in order to demonstrate the exceptional point, the passing through the exceptional point, actually. It is gold crosses in a host material which has gain in the active phase, and it is a parity times we made in order to be able to achieve the crossing, the exceptional point more easily, we just put a thinner than shown here, gain and loss layer besides the chiral metamaterials in between, so tuning the effective permittivity of the imaginary part of the permittivity of these layers. We saw this picture, here is the scattering matrix eigenvalues, and we saw this passing from the parity time symmetric phase to parity time broken phase, and in this type of system. And also we observe the simulate actually the zero optical activity and the non-zero circular dichro non-zero ellipticity of the transmitted wave in this type of system. And this brings me to the conclusions, and I hope that I showed you that combining parity time symmetry with chirality, we have some very interesting propagation features. For example, at normal incidence, we have the possibility to have independent control of parity time properties and polarization. And for oblique incidence, we have mixed parity time related phase. We have multiple exceptional points, and we can control this phase and the exceptional points by chirality and angle of incidence. And we can control actually all the polarization, the parity time symmetric features and the polarization features by angle of incidence and chirality. And besides this angle dependent polarization features, the polarization features, they are also side dependent. It means they are asymmetric. And here are a few papers that you can use if you want more information on what I showed. And I would like to thank actually our funding sources, and thank you very much for your attention. This is brings me to the end of the talk, and I think it's quite earlier than I expected. Actually, I thought that it would take much more time, so we have more time for questions.
Exactly, it's just perfect. So people, please come forward with your questions.